The last time we came out here to San Francisco, this market still was in love with the fast-growing privately held unicorns. But we're now in a post-Lyft, Uber, and WeWork world. Fortunately, some were smart enough to take a breath on their plans to come public until the market regains its appetite for these mythical creatures. Take Airbnb. It's one of only two seven-time CNBC Disruptor 50 companies. Number seven on 2019 list, now expects to come public in 2020. And get this, it doesn't need the money. So let's dig deep with Brian Chesky. He's the co-founder, CEO, and head of community at Airbnb to learn more about how his business is doing and what it means for an upcoming IPO. Mr. Chesky, welcome to Mad Money. Brian, you're solving a problem again.
Yep.
A lot of people want to go to the Japanese Olympics. They're very worried because there's just not enough hotel rooms.
Right.
You've announced something that's very important, not just for this Olympics, but for many more. Tell us.
Yeah, so... Well, Airbnb, we started to provide housing really for events. When a big event comes to town, hotels are usually sold out. People don't have a place to stay, and hotels usually charge two or three times their daily nightly rent. And when we provided the housing for the Olympics in Rio, 85,000 people stayed in an Airbnb home. These are people that may not have gone to the Olympics. And so we announced today are three things. Number one, we have a breakthrough partnership with the Olympics from now through 2028. That's five Olympic Games, where we're going to be the official housing provider for the Olympics. So you can now stay with a local when you're going to the Olympics. The number two thing is that now Olympic athletes can be Olympic experience host on Airbnb because many of them do not have multi-million dollar sponsorships from Nike. So what do they do when their career is over? Hopefully they can be host and still earn income. And the third thing I'm really proud of is the Olympics has a history of allowing countries to compete, but not every person belongs to a country. There are refugees, and they don't get the opportunity to compete. The Olympics has created a refugee Olympic team, and we're a proud sponsor of that team as well. So those are the three things that we're doing.
But to go back to you said that when you created it,
yeah.
You obviously have taken it to many different levels.
Yeah.
You bought a company that I love, Hotels Tonight. You have made it so that, and this is an amazing statistic, there was one night, August 10th, over 4 million people spending the night in an Airbnb for a private company. This
is the population of Los Angeles, approximately, were staying in Airbnbs, but they came from 191 countries. This is almost every country in the world, but North Korea, Iran, South Sudan, and Crimea. So it was a really, really big thing. And when we started Airbnb, people thought we were crazy. They said, this will never work.
Right.
Strangers will never stay with other strangers. But I think what we invented wasn't just a way to book a home. It was really a platform built around trust that allowed millions of people to be able to book a home with another person and trust the accommodations they're getting. And over 500 million guest arrivals later, you start to see what happens.
Okay, so how's the technology work? I mean, for instance, Jeff Lawson was on recently from Twilio.
Yes.
And I know he has a great platform. You must use so many different technologies to make this thing. Can you just give us a sense of the pastiche?
Yeah, so we have billions of searches every year on Airbnb, going to over 7 million listings and many experiences. So the first thing we have to do is we had to build a really, really robust platform. Airbnb's not an OTA. We are not just a distributor of online travel company. We're not just a distributor of hotel products. We had to first build a payment system, a payment entity. We handle more currencies than PayPal. And so we have to handle this money through our platform. We have a trust and safety division that verifies people's identity. We have 24/7 customer support. We have thousands of unique customer issues that we have to train. This is not like Amazon. The box either didn't come to your house or it did. This is a very, very bespoke platform. We have deep infrastructure. Even our ranking team that does search technology, trying to be able to help you find one of 100,000 homes in Paris. This is a pretty difficult problem. So it's a pretty robust platform. And I think the sophistication of it hopefully allows more people to participate.
Like many pioneers, you have arrows at your back. I meet people who run hotel companies. They're saying that you're hurting their margins. I'll hear about a town that doesn't want to have Airbnb in it. I'll also hear, hey, listen, they could be the next WeWork, Jim. Don't fall in love with them. How do you respond to those who, frankly, maybe are a degree jealous of what you've accomplished?
Well, I think that ultimately the people will speak. And the first thing is, do customers love this product? The vast majority of people who book on Airbnb leave a review, 70%. And the vast majority of them love the experience. I've seen you on the show talking about your experience.
Absolutely.
So number one, we're going to first live and die by our customers, as all companies do. And I ultimately think the customer should choose which companies survive and not survive. The second thing is that our hosts have earned over $80 billion on our platform, and 50% of them are women. And one of the top professions of our hosts are school teachers. So, like,
it's just
regular people mostly doing these activities. And ultimately, we've tried to partner with cities. We've had 500 different city partnerships. We collect and remit over $1.5 billion of hotel tax. And so it's really, you know, ultimately, Jim, what I would say is people won't remember Airbnb in 2019. They won't remember, you know, about if and, you know, what, like, any if and when we launch which feature. They're going to remember who we are as a company.
Right.
Did I like that company? Did they provide great experiences? Were people economically empowered? Were communities better off? And hopefully, if we would do our job well in the coming decades, people would all say that.
All right, let's talk about West versus East. When I'm out here, and I come out here a lot because I want to be younger than I am. This is what happens when I come out here.
Yeah.
Out West, you're talking about solving problems.
Right.
And in the East, you're talking about valuation.
Yes.
Out West, you're talking about wonder. In the East, you're talking about, is it $40 billion? Is it $50 billion? East does not necessarily have to meet West. Why would you ever want to come public knowing that East is rapacious and, I think, critical of what West has accomplished?
Well, I'm from the East Coast. I grew up in Albany, New York. Albany, New York. My parents are social workers. My dad worked for the state of New York. So I like the East Coast. I still think of myself as kind of an East Coaster. I don't think these things are mutually exclusive.
Okay.
I don't think you either have to be highly profitable or you have a change the world nonprofit. Like, you can actually make money and you can actually, like, serve Wall Street and serve your customers and like,
serve the refugees.
And serve the refugees and serve communities and do really interesting things. I think that, like, I don't think we need to live in this world where there's either, like, it's one or the other.
Okay.
Like, these two things can fit together.
At the same time, we know that, for instance, an outfit like WeWork comes public and it's looking like it's 50, then 40, then 30, and then not. How do you avoid the WeWork situation?
Well, the first thing you should do is make sure that, you know, like, you have a business that's fundamentals are really strong. That really matters.
You make money.
And so when you publish your S1, it's really important that your numbers make sense. And our business, we have more money in the bank than we've raised.
Right.
That's a really important thing. I think a question you should always ask people is, how much money did you burn to build your valuation?
Right.
And if you divide those two numbers, that's a really important thing. And so I think fundamentally when we put out our numbers, hopefully people will feel really good about what we built with what we raised and what we actually spent. But I think ultimately, like, we're not going to live and die by the things we say. We're going to live and die by the things we do and the numbers and the results we put out quarter after quarter, year after year.
Now, does it make sense then to wait? Because you have more money in the bank, and is there something that are investors anxious to have a market? Because I know that you guys have done a lot more to protect buyers of the ultimately than these sellers, or is it just it's time to have a currency?
Well, most people that are really rushing to go public, the number one reason they do is because they need the money.
Right.
We don't need to raise money, and so we haven't been in a rush. And number two, most of our large shareholders, most of our large investors have told us they intended to hold the stock for a long time.
Okay.
And they actually were doing the opposite of pressuring us to go public. They were making sure, take your time, make sure you institutionalize your intentions, because obviously it is an intense world on Wall Street, and make sure that you institutionalize the things you're doing, try to start new businesses, get them going, and then find the right timing. We think next year will be the right time for us.
Okay. And with a broker or direct listing, what do you think?
We're not ready to announce anything, but, you know, the number one reason that people do a traditional IPO is they need the money.
Right.
We don't need the money.
One last question, Brian. As someone who's in the hospitality business, I worry all the time about fighting. I worry all the time about accidents. I worry all the time about something really bad happening.
Right.
You've had some experiences like I've had, like anyone in our business had. How do you create a safety net to make it so that, as best as you can, people who use your product don't get hurt?
So when we started Airbnb, the first thing we did is make sure we have a payment system and a reputation system.
Okay.
Everyone leaves a review, both sides, and these are authenticated reviews based on a reservation. Then we provided a number of new protections. Last week, for example, we made our biggest announcement in the history of our company since we founded in our platform of trust. You see, ultimately, we're in the business not of sharing a home, but we're in the business of trust. And what we're doing with that business is now we're going to verify 100% of the listings on Airbnb. We're going to verify them them for accuracy and for basically hospitality standards. No internet platform with hundreds of millions of users has attempted, I don't think, to verify all the veracity of their information. But I think ultimately we in the tech industry are realizing we have greater responsibility and we need to actually take more responsibility for what's on our platform.
You're dead right. You're dead right. You're doing it right. Okay, that's Brian Chesky. He's the co-founder, CEO, and head of community at Airbnb. Thank you, Brian.
Thank you, Tim.
Good to talk to you. Booyah! Jim Cramer here from Mad Money. Thanks for watching CNBC on YouTube. Click here to subscribe and get the jump on my exclusives with CEOs, plus market news, investing advice, and a whole lot more.